drafted any bylaws from there, and you see our petition by law, and committee, it comes to things, things in the way that. The first question is going to be, what's the next part of the present?
Well, I suppose there you would have to say, probably trap the very thing that has been necessitated because of security needs and everything, the knowing that you don't have to worry about rush hours, or and that someone will see that you get where you're supposed to go on time. And since in the many years before this job, there was a great deal of travel in my life, why that is a significant difference.
Let me ask you somebody else, where are you looking forward to going? If you had any potential, as you'd say, even if it wasn't government, you'd like to go soon.
Where would I like to go? About 40 minutes north of, northwest of Santa Barbara, there is a ranch.
I understand.
Give it my druthers, I'd druther go there.
This is another People Magazine question. We're curious, who shops for you? How do you, who buys your socks, your shoes, your underwear, your ties?
Well, now some things, like the shoes and suits and so forth, I can do by telephone because I have the same person making those things for years and years. Other things, actually, it is a case of asking someone to do it for me. And sometimes it's here, people that I know can will get to a store.
Do you do it by catalog, David?
Well,
get Christmas catalog?
Having a ranch, yes, there's a certain amount that you can do by catalog because various farm equipment companies and suppliers of horse gear and all of that, they do have catalogs.
They brought up something that interests me. I'm a horsewoman myself, and we see these photographs of you with chiefs of the state, other heads of state, walking here as they do on their horses. And I wanted to ask you, when you go to Quantico and where you ride, tell me, do you canter, do you gallop, do you jump fences? Can you tell me the pleasure and sort of what you do?
Well, mainly it's kind of trail riding. Mm-hmm. And trail riding is, there's a lot of walking, and that's very pleasant on a horse. Some trotting and some cantering. Like, for example, if we ride up at Camp David, the trail's rather rough, and uphill and downs, so there are stretches where you can kick them into a trot or a canter, and other times while you're walking, and there's a lot of rock and so forth. And that's also true at our ranch. One thing I do miss is that for years my riding was over fences and so forth. I had hunters and jumpers. And the last one, about 12 years ago, boat attendant, and while an operation in California there could restore that so he could be ridden, it was a black thoroughbred. I never felt that I could ask him to jump. So for these years, I haven't. I miss it. I can still feel the sensation of going at one, but the years have gone by, and now I don't have any jumpers. He, incidentally, marked the end of 36 years of a single family providing my riding. I rode his mother. I rode his half-sister out of the same mare until she died. And then I had to say goodbye to him, and I added it up the other day for 36 years.
It's not being the chief executive that grounds you. The government hasn't grounded you, though.
Oh, no.
If you were given a horse, or the loaned a horse, that was a good jumper, would the CBRs let you?
What I have really been thinking about is someone told me that some of the winter days coming on here, where we won't be able to ride back here, that it's possible that I might be able to go out some afternoons to the riding, the enclosed riding hall of the park police where they do have them, and I thought out there would be the place to start again those nice circumstances and set up a jump and get my timing back and find out what it was like again.
Mr. President, the innocence that's sad to have little walks. living room security threats. They've really tied to security here. I remember when you and Mrs. Reagan first came to town in the evenings when you went to Watergate to see your friends or occasionally to the jockey club. Do you feel isolated now?
Well, no, we can still do that.
Do you do it?
Yes.
How? It's not
too long because there's a pretty heavy schedule. But no, we can do that. The things that are restricted now are those things where I think possibly, and you, as you said, the Libyan threat, those things that where I am self-conscious because I think I might be a threat to others, such as going to a crowded place.
Well, do you ever leave this place in the evenings and visit some of your friends that are paying apartments in there?
Yes.
Like who?
Well, we've had invitations here in town to our friends. I think the most recent time we were at the Deaver's house.
Did he serve you a good dinner? What
yes.
did you get?
Yes.
I want to go. Excuse me.
I couldn't remember what the menu was.
That was amazing. I wanted to ask you how often you get to see a movie, and of the movies you've seen this year, tell me the one you think was best. Perhaps you tell me the performance you think is best among the actors. Best.
Well, now, let me say, among those perks that you asked about, that's another nice one. It is possible, for example, we go to Camp David on the weekends, we run, for the two nights we're out there, we run a movie. And we can also run them here in the White House. I know that some people in the industry are going to be very angry at me, but I'll tell you. We have taken to running some of what I call the golden oldies. And you see Carol Lombard and Cary Grant up there on the screen again, and a number of others. And
you
I have to tell you, I think they were better. I think the writing was better. I think the dialogue was better. And you don't ever see anything that makes you squirm or embarrass you as you do today. And, some of the movies that are made, we do like them. Now, the most recent movie that we've seen was the result of the kindness of Father Hesburgh at Notre Dame. You know, a lot of the older movies have been on television so much that it's hard to get a print that hasn't been hacked all to pieces to get the commercials in. But Father Hesburgh and the coach of the Notre Dame football team and a group of people interested in that sort of thing came here recently and presented me with one of the two prints that is still left intact, which I now have of the Rockne film, which I played the Gipper. And I'm not going to say it was the best picture that we've seen. I'm going to say I enjoyed it more than any other.
It's not your all-time favorite, Mr. President?
In one way, it really is. It's the sentimental favorite that every actor has, the one that broke me out of those pictures that they didn't want them good, they wanted them Thursday, and put me in pictures like King's Row and so forth. And that, I think, was probably half the list as the best movie I was ever in.
Speaking of King's Row, I was just rereading your biography, Where is the Rest of Me? And you talk about your movie career and your 14-hour days, and you had this quote in it where you wrote, I became a sunny automaton creating the character someone else had written, doing still what other people told me to do. Do you ever feel that way now as President of the United States?
No, not really. In this job, you do seek counsel and advice. Our cabinet meetings are kind of like a board of directors meeting. I want to hear all the viewpoints and so forth. There are some things in which you're told, for example, when security comes in and says you're going to do this or you're not going to do that, I don't argue with them. I know that they wouldn't be saying it if there wasn't a good reason. And sometimes I get in a little argument here when they tell me whether I can or cannot talk to the press about it.
Do you ever feel overscheduled when you hear you have to talk to 45 minutes to People magazine or something?
30.
No. no, I know it's a busy schedule. But I also know it has to be. I remember, I learned my lesson as governor when the young lady was doing the scheduling for me, and there were so many appointments that I got a little rebellious, and I said, when do I have time to be governor? And I said, come on, how many of these requests for appointments do you have to turn down for every one I do? And when she said 40 for every one, I quit griping. I understood.
Would you hazard a guess as to how many it is now?
I've never asked. I don't know if there's more or less.
A lot more.
He says more.
I'd like to ask you one thing. I think once you were reported saying you felt so isolated sometimes in this place that if someone turned you loose in the heart of Washington, you might not be able to find your way home. I wondered if that was the case still. And the other part of the question was, do you ever get a longing to put on a disguise or to, in some other way, make a sub rosa trip around town so that you can see what's going on outside the gates?
Well, let me just answer that this way, that yes, there's a feeling of confinement. I think that's why Camp David looms as such a promise on the free weekends, because it's, you're in a normal size house where you can walk out the door and take a walk if you want to. Sometimes I look out there at Pennsylvania Avenue, and it isn't so much a disguise or something. It's just, you see the people bustling along, walking along the street, and it suddenly dawns on you that probably never again can you just say, hey, I'm going down to the drugstore, look at the magazines or something of that kind, and walk out the door and go walking down to a store in something of that kind. I'm not going to say it depresses you greatly, but you do find yourself remembering when in your life you could do that, and knowing that it is gone.
I was going to ask you, had you ever put on a disguise or sub rosa gone around town? You know, had one of your Secret Service take you in an unmarked car? You do that?
No, I don't think so. I had an adventure in this town once while I was still governor of California. It was the time of the great riots at the Martin Luther King. And we were trapped in an automobile in a traffic jam just 2 blocks from our hotel where I knew Nancy was waiting. And around us, and we could see, and the windows breaking, the rioting and everything that was going on. And I insisted that we obviously couldn't get there in the car, that we get out and go to the hotel on foot. And the head of my state security then, finally, very disturbed about this, finally agreed if I would wear his sunglasses. And so I said, okay, and I put on his dark glasses. We got just to the curb from the car. Great big fella stopped me and said, Ronald Reagan, can I have your autograph? I just took the glasses off and gave them back here. So I haven't tried a disguise since. But you'd asked something else there that I was going to answer in that question, the way you were.
Would you be lost in the city?
Oh, the losing in the city. Yes. Now that I discovered even in Sacramento. But what it comes from is riding in the back seat with someone else driving. I've been to Washington a number of times. But as time goes on, and when you're back here, you don't bother to watch where you're going. And right now, as many times as I've been to, say, some of the hotels here in town where you make speeches or something, if you suddenly turned me out of here at the wheel of a car and said, drive it, I wouldn't be able to do it.
Mr. President, you spoke a moment ago about looking down Pennsylvania Avenue. I was wondering, do you ever look down from the family quarters and look across the street at Lafayette Park? There's a soup kitchen set up there now where about 40 or 50 of the city's homeless are getting and hungry are getting soup. Have you ever noticed the people?
I didn't know that, but I'm going to make a point now that you told me. I didn't know that was going on. But you see, the living quarters are really on the opposite side of the White House. So the rooms on that side, there's very little occasion on the Pennsylvania Avenue side to go there and look out. The one room that I do go in when I've said that I now and then look down there at the street is the exercise room.
When you're on your bicycle.
I wanted to ask you, do you think the press was unfair in reporting seeking unemployment benefits?
Well, I think by this time, and after all the years in Sacramento, I was sure it was going to happen. This is one of the things that isn't a desirable perk, and that is the knowledge that you've imposed some of this fishbowl existence on the family. We did call him and told him that we'd be not worried about ourselves, but that he might be embarrassed doing this, but he wants his independence. And he said that the rest of the group, all of them laid off, were doing the same thing. No, he'd rather do it on his own without my help. So in one way, I had to greet that with mixed emotions. You had to worry about that happening. It did happen, but at the same time, I had to have a grudging respect.
When you were running for president, and often there were many photographs of you worshiping at the Beverly Hills Presbyterian Church,
yes.
The Beverly Moonlight. Do you go to church often here? Or have your habits changed?
No, we did regularly when we started. And I miss it very much. And I have intended lately to have some conversations again with security. But with the terrorist-type threat, that became an impossibility because, again, that would be one of the places where I could represent a threat to many others because they don't just pick you out individually, those people. They take all the surrounding territory with you.
Do you ever have any kind of worship service here?
No one has been offered. I have been religious all my life, and I just feel that he understands the situation, and he knows that I, maybe I talk to him oftener than he likes.
Oh, no.
That was what we were curious about. Has your religious outlook changed since the assassination? Do you read the Bible now?
Well, I've been not quite familiar with the Bible, and have been because I was raised. My mother was the religious mentor in our family, and she left me, raised her with a very deep and abiding faith, and I'd feel very lonely if I couldn't know there was someone I could turn to. You know, Lincoln put it best. He said, I would be the most stupid man on this footstool, earth, if I thought I could meet the problems that confront me without turning to one who is wiser than all others. But as for after the shooting, no, I don't suppose it didn't increase my faith at all, but what I learned afterward about that it was something of a close call, I didn't at the time know that.
Let's turn to a happier subject.
Well, I was just going to say that I have a feeling that whatever time's left me, he's got first claim.
That's right. I wanted to ask you, what's the best moment of your week? What's the thing that you really look forward to?
Climbing on that helicopter to go to Camp David.
This week in Time Magazine, your wife's love and affection for you just really walked off the pages of that magazine and what you were uncovering. I'd like to ask you, I've heard your quote from Clark Gable, but I'd like to ask you to talk about Nancy and what she means to you and what she means to you as a helpmate living in this big, lonesome old house.
I think I could just sum it up in a few words. I can't imagine life without her.
Well, that's beautiful, Mr. President.
I wanted to ask you, I'm a person who's responsible for people picking the 25 list of treating people of the year, and I wanted to ask you, of the people that you met or dealt with this year, for better or for worse, who would you say is the most intriguing individual? It's probably not in our selection. Someone that struck you as intriguing?
I don't know whether I could answer that, because that is one of the other things that happens in this job. The people you meet, the course of the job. First of all, you could start with national leaders, and I found out with Sadat's assassination that maybe it's because you have so much in common with regard to problems and so forth. He had been here, as you know, and it was shortly thereafter the assassination, that Nancy and I were both amazed at our great sense of personal loss. It seems that you get acquainted so quickly with them, and as I say, having so much in common, that you find that you think of them as friends. But beyond that, there is the other thing. People that come in here for sometimes special causes, so forth. A little girl that was in here recently that was that has an ailment that from birth that she's no taller than my knee and walks in a little walker, but the most cheerful, happy young lady who can speak in more than one language and is only 8 years old, and yet that tiny person, maybe like a ray of sunshine, but the young lady that spent all the way from the starting gun till the dark of night doing the marathon on crutches in here. People of that kind, people that have shown you what the indomitable human spirit can do, I can't pick one. I can just say that, well, let me sum it up and say this, that my faith in and belief in people has been so strengthened just from what I've had, the people I've had the privilege of meeting here, of that kind of leadership, kind of people who are doing great humanitarian deeds just on their own.
Speaking of the people you've had the privilege of meeting here, we were also very curious how you deal with some of them, particularly, say, Menachem Begin. How did you handle your anger? We know that Mrs. Reagan takes warm baths. She has told us in her biography. Do you pump iron? What do you do when you get mad, Mr. President? And how do you handle it?
Well, the staff tells me that I throw my glasses, reading glasses. I wasn't aware of that, but then I heard one of them saying sometime that he watch out if he throws his glasses. And now I've gotten kind of self-conscious about it. But, I get angry, and usually I try to swallow it so I won't do anything that I'll be ashamed of for the rest of the day. But Menachem Begin and I think, struck up a very close and warm friendship. And now there seems to be an estrangement over things that have been going on and differences that we had. I had a meeting scheduled with him when the tragedy of his wife's death occurred. And I was able to call him. He was in California at the time and then was to come here. And of course, we couldn't meet then. We were going to meet later on.
Is there something in Menachem Begin that you think, in all the press accounts of the man, that struck you that the press hasn't captured, the media hasn't captured? Is there a quality in the man?
Well, there is a single-mindedness in his dedication and devotion to what he's trying to do that I think does sometimes make him intolerant of other views. But when you stop to think, I've read his autobiography, when you stop to think that here was a man who suffered the persecution under the Nazis, and then and freed from that, found himself suffering the persecution under the Soviets. And that experience, and finally then, in a country for the people that had known the Holocaust, and his dedication to what he thinks is right for them. Yes, we can have discussions, and we'll have them and meet again, because sometimes, no matter how well-intentioned he is, sometimes I think that single-mindedness makes him unaware that you might be trying to help. Mm-hmm. And if he would give you a little more leeway, you could be more helpful.
You mentioned reading his biography. Tell me what other books you've read. read recently, and this is Reagan's grade. What do you enjoy reading when you're not reading your pages?
Well, this is one of the perks that's not so much fun. I am a voracious reader, and I could no more go to bed without reading myself to sleep than I could fly. And I have loved every kind of reading, from nonfiction to fiction to novels and so forth. I've got more books.
What was last night's book?
This is what I was going to say. There are more books that are lying there with a stick of a piece of paper in them where I got to. But most of the night, and last night was another one, in which by the time bedtime comes, not only what I take with me from here, but during the evening, what the ushers bring in that has come in from the offices. That's why the last thing I say to everybody when I leave here, instead of saying goodnight, I say go home. And evidently they don't. But you'd be surprised, most evenings, your reading really is interrupted by a sheaf of things that you have to read for the next day, briefing papers and so forth. And if there's going to be a visitor, you get a whole briefing book, some head of state that you don't know, and the issues that are to be discussed and so forth. And I've got one book by the bed that someone sent me that is a history of the bloodlines of Ireland. And
related to Brian Boru.
Yes.
Have you read Mrs. Raymond's book on the Quaternary
hearing? I have. I read some of it literally from the script, not from the finished book. But I know pretty much what's in it because I know what her feelings are about that program.
You haven't caught any of the reviews. Some of them have been very good, some of them have been wounding of the book.
Well, I haven't seen those. No. Maybe somebody's been keeping them from there.
Talking about books, presidents have had, recent presidents have all books put in for a library. Can you tell me, do you like that concept of having a library of all your papers and your administration? And where would it be if you plan on it?
Well, I can't answer the second part of the question yet. You know, you sort of have to have be asked if, by some institution. Yes, I guess I got used to the idea when I left California and found out what a record there was. And my California papers are at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University. Mm-hmm. And I was amazed in 8 years that I think they said there were 27 tons of them. But I also know that scholars do go, and researchers, and in fact I know of a couple from the University of California, various campuses, who went there and frankly admitted they were going to get confirmation for the unkind thoughts that they had about me, and turned around and wrote, after they saw the records, wrote the other way.
So a library is good to know.
Yes.
Where would you hazard a guess? Would you hazard a guess as where you might consider?
Eureka?
I have tried to keep them supplied with many mementos and so forth, because I have a great feeling about that little school, and it did so much for me. I don't think, however, that having seen presidential libraries and the extent of them, what they are, I think it would require a more accessible and a bigger institution than that.
We were curious, and this is really a Christmas question, and it's an unfair Christmas question, but your father did receive his unemployment blue slip on Christmas Day.
Yes, Christmas Eve.
Christmas Eve. Well, there are 10.8% Americans unemployed this Christmas Eve, and what would you have to say to them?
Well, I know it doesn't do much good to tell them. I understand that I know how they feel. I know how much worse they feel at a time like this. But I'd rather say this to a lot of other people. And that is, for every one who is unemployed in this country, there are 10 who aren't. And most people forget that we have more than 100 million people working. And it would seem to me that if Christmas means anything, that at the community level, those 10 for one ought to be looking around. They must know the people in their neighborhoods, fellow union members, people in their churches who are in that plight. And I think it's time for the 100 million or more to make sure that the 10 million, the 11 million do have a Christmas.
I have a question, Mr. Gregory, from my staunchly Republican mother, who is 82. She said, she said to me, you shouldn't be taking...
Sometimes someone tells a story or something, and one that I may have told for 20 years comes back to my mind, and out it comes.
But you really want a story for your mother?
Yes.
Of course, they have to be of a certain kind. Maybe she'd be a little bit amused about... I'll take the time to tell this. About the fellow with the one-legged, the wooden-legged pig. The pig with a wooden leg. And a man saw this and he said, what's with the wooden leg and the pig? He said, this is the most remarkable pig in the world. He said, I was plowing one day. The plow tipped, but the tractor tipped over. I was trapped under the tractor. This pig came, rooted the earth away, and got me out and saved my life. Well, he says, yes, but what about the wooden leg? And he said, let me tell you, this pig, one night, my wife and I were asleep, a coal from the fireplace fell out on the floor, set the house on fire. This pig came in, woke us, rescued us, got us out and saved our lives. He says, what about the wooden leg? Well, he says, you can't eat a remarkable pig like this all at once.
Mr. President, we have time for one more question.
Okay. Mr. President, Jimmy Carter, Lyndon Johnson, Jack Kennedy, all aged very noticeably in office. And you look wonderful. It's like another line has not been added to you, to your face. And I wonder why. Is there some inner serenity, or what do you attribute this to, the fact that you have not aged in office?
Well, I know there have been those stories, and they've told them. And when I first became governor, I think I could feel it happening to me to start with, because it seemed like I'd inherited a situation just about as bad as the one here. And it seemed like every morning there was someone standing in front of my desk when I got in there saying, we have a problem. And I think faith has something to do with it, but also I made myself a promise, and I'm still going to keep it here. And that is that I would not let anyone counsel or advise me on any issue facing me as to what the political repercussions might do, or what it might be in the next election, and how it might affect. That I only wanted to hear what was good and bad. Was it good or bad for the people to do? And I wanted to make no decision based on political considerations. And I've kept that promise. And I think maybe that might have something to do with it.
Not worrying about your political future.
That's right.
Mr. President.
That's one of the nice things about being my age.
Or being where you are.
I'm sure you haven't decided, probably you haven't decided, I should have loaded the question. In time, you said you hadn't made up your mind about the next running again. Have you changed your mind in 3 or 4 days?
No. I think this is too early to say anything of that kind. Part of the answer also for what you said is, I have a great belief in some of the things I do. I work at physically doing things, but there's an old cavalry rule that there is nothing so good for the inside of a man as the outside of a horse. And maybe that's part of it.
That's wonderful.
Thank you for taking the time.
Well, it's a pleasure.
It's been so lovely to be here.
Well,
my magazine I'm sure you would say.
Well,
thank you.
Merry Christmas to you. And give my best to your mother.
I certainly will.
Europeans, I don't think they should look right up on
thanks,
formals.
Thank you very much.
I'm suing here from the Oval Office.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.